we wanted to understand the characteristics, the way they got along with people, the way they connected with the youth and parents as well, the recruiting ability. There's so many components based on hiring a coach nowadays, but all the guys that we have on the staff come from a relationship, and they are great parents. And that's something that matters to me, because it's hard for me to give you the opportunity to lead someone's child when you're not even leading yours.
We are back. 81-21 talk. We back.
Yep, we're back.
We're back. That was Deion Sanders at the top. We played that because we have, or feel,
mm-hmm.
the same way, or how do I say it? We agree with what Deion is saying, which is, how can you expect someone to be a leader in a community or do things like teach and all these things like that? Deal with your kids when they haven't even done it for their own. What do you think about that as a topic?
I mean, it's a very serious question.
It's a very serious question. Yeah.
You know, especially if that person is aware of their kids.
Is aware.
Yes.
And ain't doing nothing for them.
Right.
But standing up like, mm-hmm. I'm this great person.
I'm this person.
Right. All right. Let's talk about it. Okay. 81-21 talk. Let's go.
It's Alan Elondi. It's got to be more careful.
Like I said, we are back. 81-21 talk. What's up, Boosie?
Nothing. Sitting here.
Yeah,
chilling.
Hey, this is a crazy subject. Mm-hmm. Is it crazy?
It's not crazy. I guess it's a little sensitive.
Sensitive.
But not crazy.
What makes it sensitive?
For that parent. That would you call it an absentee parent?
Okay, I admit, I understand that. You're right.
Mm-hmm.
I was thinking like it may be a sensitive subject for us to talk about.
Well, it is a little sensitive to me, so.
Okay.
But not because, well, I don't know. I was going to say not because he's not aware, but I mean, I don't know.
We'll set it up in exactly what you're talking about. When you say he's not aware, you're speaking of?
My biological father.
Right. You never knew him.
No, right. Never knew him, never saw him. So, but I don't know if that is because he was not aware of me. He don't know.
Right.
I know what my mother said, but now I don't know anything because she's gone.
You only got one side.
Right.
And
I really didn't get anything out of my family members.
And that's what we were talking about before we started recording when I was, you know, talking to you about the Kirk Franklin clip. I mean, mm-hmm. he never knew his dad.
Right.
And he found out that his dad was actually right down the street from where he records his music.
That's crazy.
Right. And then he also said that his son used to play at a house mm-hmm. that was attached to his father's house.
Right.
And didn't even know, you know, granddad next door.
That is so crazy.
Right. But he also said, when he presented his father with all the information, he didn't say, his father said, I never knew you existed.
That's crazy.
So, yeah, I don't know how to process that.
That is, you said that his father was 14?
He was 14. When
Kurt was born.
They didn't really say it was when he was born or when moms got pregnant. I don't know.
Mm.
But he was 14. Right? So he never knew anything about his son.
And that's so crazy because Kurt is like our age, right?
Yeah, I think in his 50s.
Yeah, so yeah. Back then, in the 60s, early, mid, late 60s, family members kept so much under wraps.
Right.
They did not let stuff get out. So it's possible that he didn't know.
Right.
But that's a different set of circumstances. Mm-hmm. We're talking about those parents.
Right.
That go home to their children every day. Or maybe not go home to their children every day, but know that they have children, might not be with the other parent that has the child,
right?
But they don't do anything. But want to stand up in the community, at school, community center,
wherever,
coaching, yeah, and say, oh, I'm all about the kids. I got your kids' best interests at heart.
And
do
have,
you really?
And they have these grand ideas about what community should be.
Right. But
celebrating community.
But if I go ask your child,
what did you do?
What did you do?
Absolutely.
For them.
Right, right.
While they was growing up, and that child says, I hardly ever saw that person.
Hardly ever.
Then what?
Right. Yeah.
Should you be allowed to be a mentor to other young minds,
or
mold
anything.
Them and guide them in anything?
Most importantly, allowed, I'm going to say / should you be listened to?
Right.
Because at the base, and we've talked about this before, mm-hmm. at the base of everything you're saying mm-hmm. is nonsense.
It is.
You can I even count on your word? Can I listen to you?
And I mean, I know there's probably extenuating circumstances in some cases.
Yeah.
But then in other cases, just that person just didn't have time for their own. But
for whatever reason,
they're doing whatever they do.
Yeah, for whatever reason.
So is right. that because of self? Because they want to be acknowledged. They want people to look at them and say, look at me. I'm this great person. I do this for these kids. And
I do this, period.
Mm.
I'm such a well thought out, logical, clean, fair, honest person. My thought process is so logical. It's persona.
But do they really care about the kids, or do they care about how they look to other people?
It's funny that you say that.
Hmm.
So when we came up with this subject, I just started researching all this stuff,
mm-hmm.
right? And trying to figure out what would make a person do that?
Mm-hmm.
Why? Okay, there are many reasons.
Mm-hmm.
But the one thing that I came up with, you know, I got notes over here.
All right.
Out of everything I look for, I came up with this title. I was looking on the internet. And a title for a person like that. They're called a high-functioning narcissist.
High-functioning. What does that mean?
It means, well, most of the time when people hear narcissist, they think egotistical or arrogant,
mm-hmm,
right?
Mm-hmm.
So we'll leave that word alone right now. But a high-functioning narcissist is in society, when you come across one, you see a person that's well presented, they socially skilled,
mm-hmm.
They work very hard at creating imagery,
mm-hmm.
and they're likable.
Right.
You feel me on that?
Yeah, I got you.
But they're a high functioning narcissist.
Right. They're able to make you believe that they are this caring, selfless person,
right. Selfless is a great word.
Empathy.
Yeah.
They got empathy yeah. and all that stuff like that.
But it's all
really
about,
it's all about them.
It's all about imagery.
Right.
And about them.
Right.
Right. And I had discovered that some of the side effects, like not side effects, but how they really are
mm-hmm.
is envious,
mm-hmm.
arrogant,
mm-hmm.
Entitled,
mm-hmm.
Grandiose.
Hmm.
And they have this a strong desire for admiration and success.
But why can't they do that with their own kids? Why do they not want their own children to admire them and look mm-hmm. up to them and follow in their footsteps?
Right. I mean, I guess you would have to ask one.
I mean, because why would you not take care of someone that comes from you, that you had a part in creating? Why would you not take care of that person? Why would you not push them, encourage them, you know, mentor them, teach them mm-hmm. about life, but then want to go out in the world and find a group of kids to get involved with and do all that for them?
I am this great person.
And then say,
imagery.
I help the kids.
Yeah.
But if you looking for the admiration and stuff like
why
that, why
own?
Not get it from your own?
Right. It's tough. It's tough when I sit back and I try to think about what is going on here when we talk about this subject matter.
Mm-hmm.
So I had to push a little deeper.
Okay. What you got?
Right. So there are different types of narcissist.
Okay.
In the parenting group.
Okay.
Right.
And we're only going to stick with parenting.
Only parent.
Right.
So a narcissistic parent, mm-hmm. that's also a high-functioning narcissist.
Okay.
But a narcissistic parent, the first one is grandiose.
Mm-hmm.
They just have an exaggerated sense of self-importance. Right. And they behave aggressively with it. Meaning, mm-hmm. the way I interpret it is, I need you to know. Mm-hmm. I'm that guy.
Right.
Right. And another one is called the enmeshed parent.
Okay.
They are what are classified as guilt trippers.
Hmm.
It's always your fault. They lay the guilt on you,
mm-hmm.
for something not happening.
Mm-hmm.
Or I didn't do what I was supposed to do because you. Or,
right, right.
Or if I may use one that I've heard before. I didn't do this for you because your mother spoiled you.
Uh-huh.
Oh, yeah, I'm coming down the middle with mm-hmm. that. But you understand? They are also, they like to keep the child under control through guilt tripping.
Right.
Enmeshed is kind of funny.
Mm-hmm.
The enmeshed, E-N-M-E-S-H-E-D,
mm-hmm.
They just like to keep their kid under control. Like right. under their wing.
Right.
I don't think I've ever encountered one like that. Have you? I don't think I've ever.
I don't think so.
Yeah.
I don't think so. I'm trying to think back through. Yeah, I don't think not like that. Not right. where. No.
So yeah, that was kind of tough. Well, if I have, I wouldn't know. Because I'm not right. there long enough to examine.
Yeah,
right.
Yeah, true, because but, you probably right. wouldn't see it like
right,
that.
Right, right. But the next one
mm-hmm.
is called, let me see, dismissive.
Mm-hmm.
Now, this parent, they have a fear of intimacy.
Mm-hmm.
So they distance themselves from their kids.
Mm-hmm.
They can be cold, unsupportive, and rarely interested in whatever their kid is doing. They don't get involved in the child's activities, the child's whereabouts.
But that type of person probably wouldn't be a coach or a teacher or anything
maybe,
like that.
Maybe not.
Hmm.
But you.
It's like, how can you do that?
But it's dismissive. So they have a fear of intimacy. So maybe they would be a coach. Maybe they would be a teacher. There's not the same intimacy as you would have with your child.
Okay, I got right. that.
Ain't you know, it's not that many cards on the table.
Right.
You know, it's a job, I'm going home.
Right, right.
But, so the next one would be, let's keep talking about them. One of the things I found interesting about this type, the dismissive type, they regret parenthood.
Mm.
But, this is crazy, when I was looking at this, because I was like, what? They regret parenthood. But they never admit it due to social taboo.
Of course.
Yeah.
If they want someone to think that they're all this, there's no way that they're going to say.
They're not going to admit it.
That I really didn't want this child.
Yeah. I really didn't want this child, or I ain't doing nothing for this child.
Right. Then, they're not going to say that.
But they might get on stage somewhere and be like, my daughter.
Yeah, I just read a book about one of those parents.
Crazy, crazy. And I'm learning all this stuff, and I'm like, whoa, right? But it helps me put things into perspective. Because
mm-hmm.
sometimes when you're trying to examine something, it helps to put a label, a word,
mm-hmm.
or put it in a box where you can really examine it.
Right.
If that makes sense. These are some of the reasons that they say that they can't be the parent, right? Health issues.
Mm.
Trauma.
Because I went through all this in my childhood, in my past.
Yeah. Financial difficulties.
Mm-hmm.
I ain't have no money, so
mm-hmm.
I couldn't take care of you.
Mm-hmm.
And lastly, emotional immaturity.
Mm.
Meaning they just ain't wrote a fuck up.
Right. You know, and we're not saying that there aren't people out there who really have those things.
By no means.
And they're doing the best they can.
But let me tell you something.
But we're talking about the ones who use it as an excuse.
Let me tell you something. Right off the top, I can choose two parents and one that's personal. Meaning, Miss Marshall used to live down the street from me.
Mm-hmm.
She had a daughter named Lucille.
Mm-hmm.
Right? And as far as I knew, she was always sick.
Mm-hmm.
Medication, mentally. Mm-hmm. Something's wrong with her. But she always had her kids.
Right.
Always.
Right.
Across the street from me, Miss Owens, mm-hmm. she had her name, I think her name was Jackie Owens, and she had two daughters.
Mm-hmm.
She was a pianist, which blew my mind, at mm-hmm. Tabernacle Church.
Mm-hmm.
She couldn't hear or speak.
Wow.
Light skinned chick.
Wow.
But she raised her two daughters.
Right.
Via sign language and whatever, mm-hmm. whatever. So, and last but not least, personally, my mother had a nervous breakdown,
mm-hmm.
ulcers, all mm-hmm. types of stuff. You know, I've seen my mother sit and cry. You get it. I'm right. not gonna get into all of that. But you know what?
She
still did what she had to do.
Right.
Which is a lot of the stuff we mentioned prior, you know, the trauma, the financial difficulties, the emotional immaturity. Man, is that really an excuse? For everybody, all the time. Notice I didn't say health issues.
Mm-hmm.
I didn't get into that because it could be mental, blah, blah, blah.
Right.
I leave that one alone.
Yeah.
But financial difficulties?
Well, you know, I have plenty of people that I've been around before that right. say, I'm not going to have kids until I'm financially stable. And I got it because, you know,
right.
maybe they watch their parents struggle to take care of them mm-hmm, and their siblings mm-hmm. or whatever.
But then,
and so they say, well, I'm not going to do that until, and that's legitimate. That's
legitimate thing. But I'm going to make you laugh real quick.
Uh-huh.
But you don't want to turn in this. See this right here? See this right here?
Mm-hmm.
All I had to do was play the 7-0. We looked at a joke where the guy was like describing those people that always show you their lottery ticket, but they didn't win.
Right.
But they want to talk you to death about, see, if I would have played 7-0-6-4, man, what'd he say? I'd have took care of you.
Yeah, I would have gave you some. I took the rest for myself. But yeah, those things are legitimate,
mm-hmm.
you know. But I felt like I wanted to go ahead and have my kids early so I can enjoy
you can grow
being
with
a parent, you know.
Yeah. Yeah.
Didn't know everything.
Of course not.
Right?
You're not going
to
know everything.
But I was still able to get out there and do things with them and what have you. Because I felt like if I waited till I was financially stable.
You could be waiting.
I might have been waiting.
You Shoot. Might be waiting.
Instead of having a shout out to my baby that turns that turned today.
Mm-hmm.
I'm not going to say her age because she wants to say that she's younger than what she is. But my oldest, Chevette, today is her birthday, so
right. and
shout
I,
out,
and
happy birthday,
I called her on the phone for an intimate birthday shout, right, mm-hmm. after everybody. She mm-hmm. didn't even answer the phone.
Mm.
Mm. I left a message. So.
Okay. But if I had waited till I was financially stable, then I would still have teenagers right now and not grown kids.
And at this age?
Yes.
Nah.
And I would have been like, ooh. The kids nah, get on my nerves. But
what you're discussing is fear.
Mm-hmm.
You see, a lot of people don't go forward with certain things because they're in fear.
Mm-hmm.
What if, what if? What if I can't? What if I don't? What if I lose? What if I'm not a good whatever?
Right.
The fear. The what ifs. The fear. Right? I get it because I've been crippled with fear mm-hmm. before. But sometimes you just gotta pull up them,
yeah.
them boots, man, and yeah. just do it.
Yeah. But that's still, none of that is a reason for you to ignore your child and give what you should have been giving your child to somebody else's children.
Especially when you look at it like this. And I want to stick it here. Wow, what a play on words. A moment of pleasure
mm-hmm.
created a life.
Yes.
Hmm. And then you go on to say, I got that moment of pleasure, but I'm not doing this.
Right.
See, let me say this. my cousin Faye in Buffalo.
Mm-hmm.
She told me something about a parent
mm-hmm.
basically telling another parent who happened to be a female, I ain't paying no child support. I ain't doing that.
Mm-hmm.
That ain't my child.
Mm-hmm.
You see, if I said something like that to you, mm-hmm. we have a child together, mm-hmm. I said something like that, I might say it in a moment, because I tell you this all the time, I'm not perfect.
Right.
I got my ways. But man, you know what I like to say, sitting on the toilet, mm-hmm. laying in the bed, sitting there alone, it's come across your mind, if you have any type of decency, you got to fix that.
Right.
For yourself.
For yourself. Yeah. You know, I'm just saying that if that's the type of person you are, then you need to be that across the board. Don't ignore your child and then go take care of other people's kids. You know what I'm saying? Don't do that. Don't take care of no kids. If you're not going to take care of your own, don't take care of nobody else's either.
And
shut
up.
Don't be up in the schools trying to coach. Don't be up in the schools trying to tutor or whatever the case may be.
Right.
Don't give any extra attention to anyone else's kids if you can't give it to your own.
That's pretty harsh.
Well, that's how I feel about it.
Let me ask you this. Let me pose this question to you. Is there a possibility that one day you can get it right, even though your own is not repairable, it's irreparable?
When you say get it right, you mean like...
let's say if you have... Okay, me and you born in the same year.
Mm-hmm.
So let's say... let's say I had a child in 1986,
mm-hmm.
right? I was just wrong.
Mm-hmm.
I didn't take care of it,
mm-hmm.
barely see me. I didn't do anything.
Mm-hmm.
I didn't add the necessary things to make that little boy / girl have at least a fighting chance to go into adulthood or teenage years.
Right.
I didn't do any of that.
Okay.
But somewhere down the line, I get married.
Mm-hmm.
And I have another child.
Mm-hmm.
I do what's right with them.
Right. But then my question is, did you go back to the other child and apologize?
That's key.
You know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
Because if you go back and you apologize and you say, hey, you know, I was this, I wasn't that, but I apologize for that.
Right.
Then that's one thing. But if you just don't acknowledge what you did wrong and you don't go to that child and say, hey, I did this wrong, but then you still want to go on and be super dad to or super mom to other mm-hmm. other kids, mm-hmm. even if they are your own, then that's not right.
It's not right at all.
You have to acknowledge. You have to try. What is it? AA, one of the steps is make amends.
Right. Right.
You need to make amends.
You need to make amends.
Now, it's up to that child to say, okay, I forgive you. Let's try to work on a relationship. But if that child doesn't say that, then you still got to do your part. And then you go on about your business and say, well, at least I tried. You know what I'm saying?
Well, you remember I said one of the characteristics earlier was, you know, the person will make you feel like,
oh, yeah,
it's because of you.
Yeah.
Now, this segues into everything that we just talked about. And these are some of the reasons that, say, if a child confronts a parent, like, mm-hmm. yo, what's good, man?
Mm-hmm.
These are some of the reasons that they might say.
Right.
Which is, the first one is, the first thing they'll do is they'll invalidate your feelings.
Yes.
I'm going to pause on that. They'll, mm-hmm. Hey, I feel a certain way. And the person will go, well, I grew up like this.
Right. What's that got to do with how I
Absolutely
feel?
Nothing. They'll dismiss your complaints or your concerns as trivial mm-hmm. or made up.
Mm-hmm.
It wasn't like that.
Right. You got it all wrong.
Yeah.
You were just a child. You don't even know what was going on.
The most hurtful one, I think, is just totally ignore you. That's mm-hmm. the next one. They might call you sensitive. Man, you need to grow up.
Right.
You grown now. You passed all that. You need to let that go.
Mm-hmm.
You being sensitive.
Mm-hmm.
I've had that personally mm-hmm. been said to me.
Right.
Let me raise my hand right now. I've had that being said. They're very unsupportive.
Mm.
You could have a passion. I want to break this down because I put an asterisk next to this one.
Mm-hmm.
You can have a passion. Let's say if your passion is, what's that thing you do with the needle and the when you make your bracelets and all that stuff. This type of excuse you might hear is, it's okay, but if I did it, it would be like this. Mm-hmm. That's one way. Or they might say, if I knew how to do that, I would be selling a million of these. That's pause right there. How would you feel?
My feelings would be hurt.
Like, and what are you saying?
Be mad. Like, what you mean?
You say you better than me? I don't
understand.
Are
you saying I'm wasting my talent? I mean, what are you saying?
Yeah, exactly. What are you saying? But all this falls under the unsupported thing. You get labeled. The difficult child. The child that doesn't listen to me. I know what went on, but hey, get over it. I wasn't there.
Right.
But I don't want to talk about that.
Right.
So you get labeled. Which in turn would lead into distance. Because remember, I gave you an example where I said, well, I come along, or this person, they get married and they have a kid. I question that. Is that imagery also?
Right.
Are you really doing it from the chest? Are you doing it from the heart? Is it imagery because you got two or three more out there that you did nothing for?
Right.
Does that make sense?
Yeah, it makes a lot of sense.
So what happens is, to the two or three that's still out there, they'll say about you, bad seed, troublemaker. All they want to do is
the black sheep of the family.
Basically. So, there's another one, but I don't want to talk about it because I think that dismissive one we just touched is usually where everything falls. When you're out on the street and you're dealing with friends that might not take care of their kids or whatever, you hear one of those things. The position I'm in, financially, trauma, man, I grew up, my mother ain't do this, so I ain't doing it for them. You know, you know all that type of stuff, right? But before we get out of here, because we got to cut this.
Well, let me ask a question.
Let's go.
So, do you think that is right for someone who's in a leadership position or with coaches? We just use Coach Prime as an example, since this is based, you know, not just based on what he said, because we've always said this, but like you always say, sometimes people don't hear what you say unless you have that platform.
He has a platform.
Right. So do you think that is his responsibility to make sure that whoever he brings on his coaching staff should be the type of person that takes care of their children before he bring this person in to take care of somebody else's children?
Yes.
I mean, I know that these are college kids, but they're young. They're just starting out in their life.
You're
they
teaching
need
them
that.
To become men.
Yeah.
Yes, I do feel that. I feel that you should vet. I use that word quite a bit.
Yes, vet.
You should vet and see what's going on in that person's life.
Yeah.
Because everybody just be talking. Not everybody.
Right.
But a lot of people just be talking.
Right. Well, I think that I can't even get my words out. I agree with what he said and what he's doing. Because if I was sending my child to school, or my grandsons, I got high hopes of them both playing in the NFL.
Right.
But if I'm sending them off to a school on a scholarship for football or what have you, I would want that head coach or the person who's in charge of that department to make sure that they surround my children or my grandchildren with positive role models. So,
and they'll know what it feels like for you to send them off, because they have their own.
Exactly.
And they would know how it would feel to send theirs off. Right?
Yep.
So there isn't a solution.
There isn't.
Now, let's end it with this.
Okay.
There's a solution. You can't stop this stuff. What that happens, because you are, as a child, you are
powerless.
Yeah. So I've always heard, live and let live. Just move on. Do you agree with that?
I mean, that's basically all you can do, because you can't control anyone else's actions, their reactions. You can only control yours.
So find a way to settle it in your mind.
Mm-hmm. Find peace with it and keep moving.
And keep moving. Yeah. That person is what they are. They primarily define what they are.
Right.
Right. Right. So.
Yeah.
What can you do?
Make peace, move on.
And we're speaking to the child.
Yes.
We are not speaking to some deadbeat parent.
Right.
We're talking to the child.
Mm-hmm.
Because no matter what you think, I'm 55 years old,
mm-hmm.
but I'm still somebody's child.
Exactly.
And every now and then, I feel those moments like, man, I could have did this.
Mm-hmm.
Or it could have been like this for me.
Right.
And you can get caught up in the what if.
Mm-hmm.
What a what if never came and it doesn't exist.
Mm-hmm.
So you're saying, for anyone that's listening, find a way to make peace with it.
Yes.
Take us out.
All right. So, America, we through. But just think about it. Think about it. I didn't mean we through like that. But think about it. You know, if this is you, if you were in that situation where one or both of your parents kind of didn't pay too much attention to you, right. and everything, it's not because you're not worthy.
Mm-hmm.
It's not you. It was them. So mm-hmm. find that love within yourself, make peace with it, and move on.
Move on. And move if on. You have kids, don't do it.
Don't do it.
Right.
Yeah.
You've endured gaslighting. You've endured guilt tripping.
Mm-hmm.
You've endured feeling like nothing, being ignored. You've endured non-support. Take it. Learn from it.
Yeah.
And don't be that way with your own.
That's it.
We out of here.
All right.
We out of here.